Listening Library presents Being Jazz, My Life as a Transgender Teen. This is Jazz Jennings. This book is dedicated to those kids who have lost their lives because they couldn't live as their true, authentic selves, and to trans youth worldwide who are paving the way for those who follow. Chapter 1. When is the good fairy going to come with her magic wand? When did you first know? I get asked a lot of questions about my life, and that's the one that comes up the most. The answer is easy. Ever since I could form coherent thoughts, I knew I was a girl trapped inside a boy's body. There was never any confusion in my mind. The confusing part was why no one else could see what was wrong. When my mom, Jeanette, got pregnant with me, she was convinced she was going to have a girl. At her baby shower, her friends all crowded around her belly and did the necklace test, that old-timey trick that's supposed to predict what kind of baby a woman is going to have. You hold a necklace with something heavy attached to it, like a pendant or a ring, over a pregnant belly, and if it swings back and forth, it means she's having a boy. If it moves in a circle, a girl is supposedly on the way. This witchy little version of a gender test ultrasound nailed it with every single one of my mom's pregnancies. It just took a little longer for everyone to realize the fetus fairies actually got it right with me. When mom was pregnant with my older sister, Ari, she and my dad, Greg, had just moved to Florida so he could start his law practice. She only had a few new friends at the time, so she didn't have an official baby shower, but still did the necklace test with her pals from Lama's class. It circled around, and mom gained a lot of weight, she tells me mostly in her face and butt. When she got pregnant again with my twin brothers, Griffin and Sander, 2 years later and had an official shower, the necklace marched back and forth like a little soldier. With the boys, she barely gained any weight. No one could tell she had a bun in the oven if they looked at her from the back, which is especially weird since she had a couple of them in there. I was a surprise. When my mom first started feeling sick less than a couple of years after the twins, she thought she had the flu. As soon as she realized what was really happening and began putting on tons of weight, she knew she was going to have another daughter, even before her friends did the necklace trick for the third time in her life, and it spun around in circles like crazy. Everything about the pregnancy was identical to what she had gone through with Ari, so she was completely shocked when the official ultrasound revealed a penis on my body. My dad didn't really believe any of the old wives' tales that my mom was into, but he always smiled and nodded along with what she said. He's sweet like that. My parents have known each other almost their entire lives. They were neighbors growing up in upstate New York and met when my mom was 5 years old and dad was 4. Their fathers were doctors who worked at the same hospital, and their mothers were good friends. But when mom was little, she just thought of my dad as the annoying kid who lived a few houses down, and she wanted nothing to do with him. As he got older, he became kind of a troublemaker with a loud mouth. But he finally calmed down around age 10, when his parents threatened to ship him off to military school if he didn't get his act together. All the time my mom was ignoring him, dad had a crush on her from afar, despite knowing they weren't each other's type. He'd sneak glances at her at the local pool, and when they were older and in high school, he even loaned her his jacket one night when he saw her shivering at a soccer game. They didn't get together until years later, when dad's brother proposed to one of mom's friends. My mom's parents were invited to the engagement party along with mom, and both of their mothers sat mom and dad down at a table to look over a photo album with pictures of the spot in Europe where the proposal had happened. One by one, everyone got up from the table and left, leaving mom and dad alone. Mom was impressed that he'd finally shaved off the mustache she'd never liked, and it was obvious he had been working out. He no longer looked like the scrawny kid next door. They went on their first date that very same night after the party ended and saw Bride of Chucky, the fourth and most romantic installment of the Child's Play killer doll film franchise. The movie must have worked its magic because they moved in together not long after. When Dad got into law school in Columbus, Ohio, Mom agreed to move there with him, but only if he proposed first. So he did. When I finally came along 7 years later, they named me Jaren. A compromise between Jordan and Aaron. Dad was pushing hard for Jordan, but my mom had once dated a guy with that name, so she shot that down. For a while, they settled on Owen, but then they switched to the Jordan and Aaron combo. It was conveniently gender neutral, which would come in very handy down the road. As I began to grow, my family thought my obsessive interest in girly things was just a normal developmental phase. I have really strong memories of the emotions I felt before I could speak, as well as my actions. I figured out how to undo the snaps on my onesie to turn it into a dress shortly after I began to walk. Like any kid, I took a lot of baths with my brothers and sister, and I'd compare my genitals to theirs. My little penis felt so wrong on me. I wished I could take the sponge and wipe it off, and behind it I'd magically find a vagina like what my sister and my mom had. It definitely bothered me, but I remember feeling frustrated and confused more than anything else. It was a strange growth hanging off me that didn't look at all like it belonged there. When I finally did start to talk, I'd say, "Dwes, like awi," to my mom every time she put clothes on me. She misunderstood, thinking I was trying to show off my independence and letting her know that I could dress myself just like my older sister did. I get why she would have assumed that at first. I was an extremely self-reliant toddler. Here's a good example of just how in control I like to be. At night, I slept with a pair of blankets, each covered with the same Noah's Ark print of animals marching two by two. I liked to keep my temperature perfectly regulated while I slept, so I'd cover up with one blanket and keep the other by my side. I'd wake up as soon as I got too warm and immediately switch the covers, pulling the cooler one over me, the way most people flip their pillow on a hot summer night. I'd continue switching the blankets all night long, barely waking myself up in the process. I wasn't going to settle for anything less than what made me the most comfortable. And during the day, what made me comfortable was wearing a dress. Around the house, I was pretty much allowed to wear whatever I wanted. I'd steal Ari's oversized pink or purple t-shirts and wobble around the kitchen in dress-up heels covered in feathers. In fact, I first started wearing those heels back when I was still in diapers. My parents were cool about it, but drew the line at going out in public dressing girl stuff. Mom would put me in shorts styled for boys, and I'd scream and cry as she dragged me to the car. I didn't just like girly clothing. I felt ashamed and humiliated if I had to wear anything else. Sometimes it helps people understand the feeling better if I put it like this. Imagine a young boy who is super into trucks and cars and playing in the mud. Then imagine that every time his parents take him out in public, they parade him around in a pink frilly dress with a parasol. The humiliation he'd feel is exactly the same humiliation I felt having to wear plain shorts and a t-shirt. I couldn't understand why my parents, who were as loving and caring as anyone could hope for, would force me to go through that kind of torture. The more words I learned, the more I started to verbalize my feelings. Whenever my mom or dad would compliment me by saying something like, "Good boy," I'd immediately correct them. "No, good girl." When I was around 2 years old, I had what I now refer to as the good fairy dream. After a long morning of playing with Ari's dolls, dressing them up and staring enviously at the smooth area between their legs, I took a nap in my sister's bed. I had no idea that I was asleep. The world seemed crystal clear as a grown woman wearing a blue gown floated into the room. She wasn't quite like the imaginary creatures you see in cartoons, but I knew instinctively that she was a fairy, thanks to her gossamer wings, the glowing light all around her, and the magic wand that suddenly appeared in her hand. Other than those fantasy details, she looked and acted like an adult, full of purpose and authority. I don't remember her exact words, or even if she spoke out loud at all. But I knew why she was there. She promised to use her wand to turn my penis into a vagina. I was ecstatic when I woke up. I felt like all the answers to my prayers were possible. The dream had felt so true, so real, that I knew it was just a matter of time before the fairy would appear again and do what she'd said she could do. I ran downstairs and found my mother sitting in our living room.
"When is the good fairy going to come with her magic wand?" I asked.
"The who?"
"The good fairy will turn my penis into a vagina."
My mom tells me now that this was a huge turning point for her. The first time she truly began to realize that what I was going through probably wasn't a phase. I remember being crushed when she said no fairy was going to come for me. I had been filled with so much hope when I'd woken up, and it was destroyed within a matter of minutes. In response, I started to assert myself even more. My mom's parents, Grandma Jackie and Grandpa Jack, were visiting us from New York not long after I had the good fairy dream. They've since moved down here to Florida full-time. While I don't remember this specific moment, they tell me they were sitting in the living room when I marched down the stairs wearing a flounce.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.